and sisters, my talk is entitled Journey to Marxism because, quite frankly, I've been obsessed with the idea of revolutionary change in Jamaica from a young age. So let me start by making a case for the connection between Marxism and the quest for revolutionary change in Jamaica. Admittedly, growth and development have taken place in Jamaica since the Jamaican political ruling class came to power, to full power in 1962. You look around you and you see buildings and highways that have been constructed. We have cell phones and the internet. Most of the country has received electricity, though access to potable water or safe water lags behind electricity. From a superficial perspective, this development might seem impressive, but on closer inspection, we see that one class is really developing, while the masses of the people are either standing still or sliding in terms of their share of national income. Per capita income in Jamaica is $3,400 a year. The minimum wage is $2,000 Jamaican a week. And according to a World Bank report some years ago, the top 20% of the population account for more than 60% of income. 14% of the population live below the poverty line, while unemployment is alleged to be around 12 to 14% of the workforce. The only persons who believe this unemployment figure, apparently, are the people at Statin who compile it. This government certainly doesn't believe it, and the previous government didn't seem to believe it either, having conceded during the election campaign that they had failed in creating jobs. And when we factor in underemployment and those who have given up looking for work, we have a serious unemployment problem in this country. And it is not only at the low end of the scale that there is joblessness, because it is reported that there are over 3,000 university graduates who can't find work. It is not necessary for me to describe the kinds of extreme poverty that exists in some inner city communities. Just take a trip to the constituency of the former Prime Minister, for example, to see what I'm talking about. In the Majestic Gardens community, the people's homes are literally surrounded by raw sewage. There's no pipe water into their homes, and they have to use community showers and toilets, half of which don't work. I'm not just singling out the former Prime Minister's constituency, because this is replicated all over the island. But there's another Jamaica that is doing quite well, and I don't have to describe their opulence. They flaunt it every day. They have education, they have the best jobs, they are the managerial class which run the state machinery, both and the public and private corporations. Then comes the super rich who are in another stratosphere. They have managed by fair and foul means to accumulate capital and to be able to dictate the kind of Jamaica in which we live. They have interlocking control of business and the media. They're in a very powerful position to impose upon us what is their view of the world. The real story about our capitalist ruling class, however, is that they are junior partners to imperialism. Years ago, Mao Zedong referred to them as the running dogs of imperialism. Some academics politely call them the comprador bourgeoisie, or the underdeveloped bourgeoisie. Any term which you prefer, their main role is to facilitate imperialist penetration and exploitation, and for that they are rewarded handsomely. In the long run, you cannot bring about revolutionary change to any aspect of the economy without running headlong into imperialism and their junior partners. Whichever one you buck up first, the other is sure to be right behind. I don't have the time to go into the history of our political economy. I'm sure many of you are quite aware of that history. Indeed, in order to understand how our economy works, it is not economics that you need to understand. It is history that you need to study. I will, however, mention a couple more statistics to explain our dependent political economy. Approximately 70% of the budget goes to pay debt. And this debt is about 120% of GDP. Our foreign debt in 1980 was approximately $2 billion U.S. dollars. Today, it is near $6 billion. During that period, however, $16 billion U.S. dollars have been paid out compared to the $6 billion that is owed. In other words, we have paid out $16 billion and we still owe $6 billion U.S. dollars. So, what is happening is that we have paid off the debt many times over, but it keeps on growing and we keep on paying. In other words, we are paying out money that could be used to educate our people, provide proper health care, and so on. That is how imperialism keeps us trapped. Our constitution, which was written by our bourgeois politicians, including national heroes Norman Manley and Alexander Bustamante, and ex-Prime Minister Edward Sciarra, along with Mother England, says that the debt, says that debts have a first claim on the consolidated fund. In other words, we cannot renege on paid debt. It is no accident that this is in the Constitution. These gentlemen knew exactly what they were doing. This debt bondage, I should add, doesn't take into account the trailer loads of money that is shipped out as profits. A few weeks ago, it was reported in the press that $13 billion Jamaica was shipped out as profits for the first quarter of this year. Multiply that by three and choose any number of years you wish, and you will understand what our debt situation is all about and the fact that capital is being shipped out of the country. So then when we talk about a shortage of capital to build the country, there's really no shortage of capital. It is only that the capital produced by the Jamaican working people is accumulated outside the country in foreign hands. And when you need capital for development, you have to go and borrow what you've already produced. But don't get me wrong, capital is also being accumulated right here in Jamaica. The Jamaican capitalists might be junior partners to imperialism, but they are also getting quite fat, sucking the blood of the people. Of the $1 trillion national debt, 55% of that amount is owed to Jamaican capitalists. And I'm sure you would like to know who these capitalists are and how they come to be such big players in the debt business. About this, I'll say more in my conclusion. So, Bruce Golding is completely missing the point when he says that we all can be rich. Some of us are rich because we live off the labor of others. He was correct, however, when he said we don't have to be poor. The question is, what to do about this poverty? And yes, he's correct, Jamaica needs a change. We need to change course. But this change cannot be the kind of change that took place last September. That was no change at all. What change can there be when the PNP and the GLP are but just different wings of the same bird? Twiddly-dee and twiddly-dum. If you look at the statistics, you will see that each election, less and less people are bothering to vote. And this last election was no exception. At least half of the eligible voters did not vote. What the people are clearly saying is that they don't believe in this sham democracy. If you stop to analyze the types of issues people have been struggling over, demonstrating over, and mostly in a spontaneous way, you will see that what the people are objectively fighting for is control over the economy and politics of the country, control over the workplace, the communities, and the decision-making apparatus of the state. Instead of just allowing people to vote every 5 years, let's have a system where there can be referenda for people to vote for what they really want. Golding's plan for improving democracy is not about giving more direct power to the people. His plan is to reform Parliament so that he and his colleagues can govern more effectively in order to give away the fruits of the people's labor. And that is not rhetoric. Nothing will change when only a tiny minority make all the decisions. The decisions are made first and foremost in their own interests, which is profits. A socialist system, on the other hand, is one which is based on the rule of the working people. The working people are the majority class, and it stands to reason that if it is the working people who produce profits and the capital, then they must, under a socialist system, move to take control of the means of production by expropriation. They have to take control of the state machinery and use it to plan the economy and to attack the class basis of poverty. Now, what I've just said is normally the conclusion to a speech about socialism. And the audience usually goes home saying, fine, but you know, how do we get to this socialism? So I want to, you know, try and change things up a bit in order to expand upon how we try to get to this socialism. But it is also important to say that there is no blueprint for socialist revolution. And while we could extensively engage in looking at theories of revolution, I do want to say the following. One, the first is that the prerequisites for making a revolution is the existence of a revolutionary organization. The second point is that such an organization must be guided by Marxist theory. Now, what do we mean by Marxist theory? There's a lot to be said about this. There has been much confusion about Marxism, especially since the collapse of the Soviet Union. Some people believe in that somehow the idea of Marxism and socialism have been discredited. Nothing could be further from the truth, though there are lessons to be learned from that experience. But I just want to read a quote from Engels, Marx's collaborator, in order to show the spirit of Marxism, which it inherited from its intellectual predecessor, the Enlightenment, the spirit which is still applicable when you are irreconcilably opposed to a system such as ours, capitalism. Engels says, and I quote, "Modern socialism is, in its essence, the direct product of the recognition, on the one hand, of the class antagonisms existing in the society of today between the proprietors and non-proprietors, between capitalists and wage workers, on the other hand, of the anarchy existing in production. But in its theoretical form, modern socialism originally appears ostensibly as a more logical extension of the principles laid down by the great French philosophers of the 18th century. Like every new theory, modern socialism had at first to connect with the intellectual stocking trade ready to its hand, however deeply its roots lay in material economic facts. Now, the principles and the spirit inherited from the Enlightenment period is what I find most intriguing." And Engels continues, "The great men who in France prepared men's minds for the coming revolution were themselves extreme revolutionists. They recognized no external authority of any kind whatever. Religion, natural science, society, political institutions, everything was subjected to the most unsparing criticism. Everything must justify its existence before the judgment seat of reason or give up existence. Reason became the sole measure of everything." He continues in another part of the same quote, "Every form of society and government then existed. Every old traditional notion was flung into the lumber room as irrational. The world had hitherto allowed itself to be led solely by prejudices. Everything in the past deserved only pity and contempt. Now, for the first time, appeared the light of day. Henceforth, superstition, injustice, privilege, oppression were to be superseded by eternal truth, eternal right, equality based on nature, and the inalienable rights of man." Of course, these extreme revolutionists ended up supporting the bourgeois revolution and consequently lost that sense of extremism and questioning of everything. But it is that same sense of extremism and questioning that Marxism inherited, which carries over into today's struggle against superstition, injustice, privilege, and oppression. In other words, our struggle against capitalism.